I don't like being told something can't be done, so I built one anyway. My name's Ricky. Today I'm going to show you not only how I built this enclosure, but how you can build it too. Just find the link in the description below, find all the plans and free STLs. Why do you want an enclosure? There are four main reasons why you want to put your 3D printer inside an enclosure. The first one is heat. We've got a temperature controlled environment. We can change the temperature. Now that's not only heating it up, but also cooling it down if it gets too warm. One big problem that a lot of people have with 3D printers is bed adhesion. Drafts and changes in temperature affect how your print shrinks and contracts. This can pull edges off the bed. Another big reason to keep a printer in an enclosure is to keep it clean. Now, depending on what environment you keep your 3D printer in, sooner or later you're probably going to have a problem with dust building up on components. We obviously want to keep everything as clean as possible, so putting your printer inside an enclosure helps to keep the dust down. Another reason for putting your printer inside an enclosure is for safety. If you've got kids or pets around, you don't want little paws or hands going in the belts. And the final and potentially most important reason for putting your 3D printer inside an enclosure is fumes. Filaments such as PLA and PETG don't really give off any harmful fumes, and they're okay being inside your house. But if you start printing things like ABS, an enclosure and ventilation is a must. Once you've put your printer in an enclosure, you can start thinking about ventilating those fumes outside of your home or garage. Now, the reason why people say you can't put an enclosure on a CR-10s Pro is the positioning of the electronics below the print bed. If you were to put the whole printer inside one big enclosure, any heat that you generate in your print chamber would transfer to the electronics and overheat the electronics. What we're doing is separating the two sides of the enclosure with a heat chamber and an electronics enclosure, and we're using fans to cool the electronics underneath. The only problem with doing this is the screen is also located on the lower part of the base. It's extremely difficult to enclose the top part of the printer and still have access to the touch screen below. The way I get around this is I move the screen. This is surprisingly easily done with a little bit of soldering, which I'll run you through in part two of the video. The other thing I've done in this enclosure, which I haven't seen other people do with this printer, is to turn everything through 90 degrees. I didn't have enough space to have the printer sticking out from the wall 700 mil or so. So I thought I'd try out turning the printer through 90 degrees so that you access everything from the side. I've been using this enclosure for about 6 months now. I wanted to give it a really good test before I recommended anybody else build it. And actually, I got used to it straight away. The only time where you have to be mindful of the fact that the printer is sideways is when you're doing bed leveling. You just have to be mindful that your front right is now your right rear. It's really not a big deal. Everything has come off the bed easily and I've had full access through the side door. And actually, having the printer this way around makes loading the filament even easier than it was before. I've allowed access to the SD card with this finger guard 3D printed piece. This can be a little bit fiddly getting the card in because you can't see the slot, but you get used to it very quickly. In future, I plan on adding remote connection to my printer, so I won't even need the SD card. Okay, so let's crack on with the build. First thing to do, as I said, is to grab all the files. So you should now have all of your plans and all of your STLs ready to print. Get your 3D printed parts printed out. There aren't a lot of them. And then you need to decide on your sheet material that you're going to build your enclosure out of. Now, I've used 9mm plywood. You don't have to use this. You can use any similar size sheet material. I wouldn't go much thinner, and I wouldn't really go much more than about 1/2 inch or 13mm. Now, you can go thicker, but you're just going to make your enclosure bigger and bigger. I've also used 15mm pine strip wood as battens to hold all of the sheets together. Within reason, you can change the size of these as well. Now, drop me a comment down below with the sheet thickness you can use. I'll run it through my CAD program and spit out some plans at the other end and add them to the files. If you've been enjoying any of my videos, then why not think about supporting the channel? Just click the Buy Me A Coffee link down below. Don't worry, you don't have to actually buy me a coffee, but if you click follow, you can see what I'm up to next and see how you can help the channel grow. Cheers. Now, at this point, I'm going to assume that you've already got your sheet material cut to the sizes as per the plans. Now, using the 9mm ply, it's possible to get all of the panels out of one 8x4 sheet. If you use something thicker, you may just go over that and may go into a second sheet. So that's another reason for trying to keep the size similar to what I've used. Now, I cut all of my sheets out pretty much by hand or with some basic power tools, but you could go as far as to give the files to a laser cutting company and ask them to cut them all out for you. It's really up to you. Once you've cut out your sheet materials, it's a good idea to mark on them what panel they are. So you'll have your top, your back, your left-hand side, your right-hand side, and your front panel. Mark them all on the inside because the plan is to cover these all up later. Now, I'm going to run through all the stages of the build quite quickly so the video doesn't drag on too much, but if you do need to pause or change the video speed, then do so. Now, in part one of the video, I'm going to build the outer box And then part two, I'm going to get onto the electronics that you need to change. It's nothing drastic, just a little bit of soldering or maybe some inventive crimping of cables. You just need to extend a bit of wiring. If you don't want to miss out on part two, make sure you hit like and subscribe down below. Okay, let's crack on. All right, first thing to do is get your back panel and put one batten along the top edge. Now this is your 700mm or longest edge. Then put battens down both sides the full length. Now you need to measure your printer base height as shown here. Now in theory, they should all be the same, minus 67mm, but measure this on your own just in case you've got different size feet for some strange reason. Take this measurement and draw a line measured up from the bottom of this back sheet. Okay, now attach a batten all the way across, but measure down your sheet thickness from the line you just drew and put your batten on this line. This is because the sheet that you're going to attach here is going to be level with the top of your printer base. So you need to be quite accurate with how you're measuring, otherwise you're going to end up with that panel being in a slightly different position. Don't worry, this is about as technical as this gets. Okay, that's all the battens added to your rear panel. Now when I say add the battens to the sheet, what I mean is place the battens in position and screw from the outside of the sheet into your batten. You want to choose screws that are not going to stick out the other side, but also get into the batten in quite a decent way. So with my 9mm ply and my 15mm batten, it means I can use something around 20mm long. I pilot drilled all of my battens, but I'm pretty fussy with that sort of stuff. Have a couple of trials and some scrap pieces, work out the best method for you. Now grab your top panel and put a batten all the way along the front edge, which again is the 700mm long side. Put the top panel to one side and grab your front panel. And this is the first panel where you need to pay attention to what's your front and what is your back. If you set your panel up like I've shown here in the video, you won't go wrong. Again, you need to draw a line that mirrors your back panel so that the line wants to be the same distance up from the bottom edge as you drew on your back panel. Again, measure down from this line your sheet thickness and place the batten. Now cut a 400mm long piece of batten and place it up the side as shown here. Okay, now get your back panel again, lay it down flat on its back and attach your top panel as shown with the batten at the top. Screw on your left hand and right hand side panels as shown. Now you want to add battens into the top edges where your side panels meet your top. Now you have the majority of your box screwed together, take your front panel, lay it in position and attach down the left hand side and along the top. Now you want to place battens on the left and right hand side where your front and rear divider panel battens meet. Now you want to attach your magnetic catches to the front panel as shown in the drawing. Now you want to cut this batten here, which fits in between the top edge into the door opening. Cut this piece, but don't actually screw it in just yet because you're going to need to screw through in the same holes where you put your hinge on for your door. So it's best to just tape this in position for now. If you've stood your enclosure up at this point, lay it back down on its back so that your mag catches and front panel are facing up. Take the other side of your mag catches with the double-sided tape on the back and place them on top of your magnetic catches that you've already screwed to the front panel. Now take your door and carefully align it in the right position and sit it down onto your magnetic catches so that the double-sided tape sticks the catches to your door in the right position. Okay, now you need to add some foam tape either onto your door or onto your front panel. The difficult part here is that there's a very small gap between your magnetic catches and where your screen flange is going to go. The best thing to do at this point is to take the screen flange that you 3D printed and place it in position, lining up the left-hand side with the outer edge of the enclosure. You want your foam tape touching your front panel and your door and providing a seal. You don't want it sitting proud because the screen flange actually sits slightly inside of the door. And there are a couple of different ways you can add the hinge to the door on the right-hand side panel. The way I did it was to attach the hinge to the door first, lining it all up, hanging it off an edge like you see here. And then I sat the door back in position, put a little bit of weight on top of it so it slightly compressed the foam seal. I then lined the hinge up with the right-hand side panel and drilled through all of the holes. At this point, you can then screw through into the batten that we taped on the other side and your door's attached. Now remove your door and remove your front panel and we're going to check that the divider panel fits in properly. Once you know the divider panel fits inside your enclosure properly, you now need to check it on your actual printer. Carefully place the divider panel over your printer as shown Now you will find a little bit of filing and cutting might be needed so that this panel doesn't foul on bolt heads. Just take your time and make sure you don't damage everything as you're taking it on and off of the printer. Now remove the left-hand side panel from your enclosure and slide the whole of the back, right-hand side and top of the enclosure around your printer so that you can see it all fit together with the printer and the divider panel. Reattach your left-hand side panel so you can see everything lined up. Now's a good time to put a small 80mm batten in the top corner where the front panel meets the left-hand side panel. Now you can refit your front panel and your door. And this is the basic structure of your enclosure done. Now it's at this point you might want to take everything apart and put heat-proof material on the inside of every surface. I use an insulation that's designed for underfloor heating and some aluminium tape for all the battens. To help insulate the two different sides of the printer, the top section and the electronics, put some of the aluminium tape on the top surface of the printer base as shown here. Now we have the basic structure of our 3D printer enclosure finished. Join me in part 2 when we'll be connecting up our screen and adding some fans so we can actually start using our enclosure.